Poncho Sanchez with Conga Blue. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid, and it's a very interesting day. I hope you will agree when all is said and done, and we've had a chance to talk with each other. Lots going on. All eyes, of course, are on the Senate races in Georgia, where there is one winner declared and another one soon to be declared when the figures are confirmed. But we shall see. It's not over. This is far from over. And that's what I want to talk about today. You know, it's a very interesting thing when you live in a country that is certainly not at all one-dimensional. And it's at times like this that you realize how complex and complicated the social, political, and economic spheres are, and how people in them are affected every single day. We don't get that as much until there is an election, and these issues crawl out of the woodwork, and you see sometimes for the first time you get a glimpse of what America is really about, how people are really living in this country and the things that concern them. Well, as you know, Donald Trump was the big force behind these two elections and more. He has taken it upon himself as the knight in shining armor to restore America to what it used to be, as if that is something desirable. When people start using phrases like what it used to be and how you long for the good old days and things like that, it amounts to the same thing. They know the America that used to be, because the America that used to be was strictly about white supremacy. And in that milieu, they understood that their interests and concerns would dominate everything. Everybody else, you know, just step to the back of the line. If we get to you at all, we'll get to you soon enough. But this is a country in which we, this is when they start talking about we have a particular vision. We all share it. We all understand it. There are other people on the flip side of that kind of thinking who understand that they're not part of it at all. They are the people that things happen to. They're not the people who make things happen. They're not at the center of power. They are on the periphery, always on the periphery. And they are to be very glad that even on the periphery, they benefit from being Americans. That's right. So we have a very long and sordid history, and it's hard to understand. For many people, it's very, very hard to understand how people have functioned all these years with that kind of an attitude and that kind of reality, because that reality is buttressed and supported by institutions, social, political, economic institutions, but mostly by the law, whatever the law is. So we have a very separate and distinct history. It actually has paralleled the history that is popularly known, but it is not heard about, it's not seen, but it exists. And from time to time, we get an opportunity to appreciate the flip side of America's racial coin. So, what is the exercise I want us to talk about today? Because there'll be a lot to digest during the course of the day having to do with the outcome of the Senate elections in Georgia. But what we want to do is we want to put you in a mindset, a mind frame that you seldom perhaps have been in. And that is to take charge, in a way, of the information that is to be shared about the time we're in, about the circumstances we are in as a nation, and particularly so as we like to think of ourselves as a grouping, people who share, we call it progressive ideas, liberal ideas, whatever the adjective is that you would like to use, but certainly not the ideas of old, certainly not the vision of yesteryear. And that's exactly where the country is right now. It is having to confront the logical consequence of the way we have lived as a nation for hundreds of years. Some people are destined to rule, others to be ruled. Some people have wealth, others are to generate that wealth, but not for themselves, of course. Some people have privilege, most others do not. So I'm going to assign you as a noted journalist today. And you are a noted journalist for a respected international magazine. You have been covering for years politics in the United States and burgeoning grassroots movements and their impact on the nation. You have just been designated as a journalist of great merit and broad experience. You are to give us a glimpse today of a special report that you have begun to put together. Your special report on the political situation is eagerly anticipated, since decision makers all over the world pay close attention and will continue to pay close attention to your analysis. What will your 2021 special report tell them about the state of affairs in the United States? I know. You say, I can't do that. Of course you can. You lived it. And what you're asked to do is to just add dimension to your experiences and to your expertise just living in America. How will you, putting together this special report, this fictional special report that we're talking about, in which you are reporting about the state of affairs in the United States. Could you imagine yourself doing such a report? You do it every day. You do it every day. You don't have to be a journalist, quote unquote. You've been living in the United States every day for many years now. And I bring this to your attention only to awaken in all of us a recognition and a consciousness that these are the kinds of things we need not only to notice, but we need to record, meaning we need to put it on the record as to what actually is our life like in the United States. What are we actually experiencing in this country? So that is the assignment. Don't be daunted by it. It is actually what you do every single day without knowing it, without being aware of it. But I'm asking you to become specifically aware today, because you have just been designated a correspondent. And you will be telling us in your special report some of the most significant developments that have shaped what we know as life today. You know the number? 888-874-4888 is the number to call. Let's see how you deal with that. Let's see how you deal with this assignment, because it is happening every day. And we haven't gotten a comprehensive accounting, I would say. We get bits and pieces of it as needed by the power structures, what it is they think we need to know. And certain things we need to know, in their view, so that we can be made to respond the way they want us to respond. You get my meaning? So you now are putting together the special report based on recent events, recent developments, and you are going to be telling us from your perspective, because you've been studying this for a while, what is it that we are experiencing as a nation? What is it? And in what ways are we experiencing different things because of the structure, the social, political, and economic structure of this nation? Are you up to it? Let's see. 888-874-4888. 888-874-4888. This is a kind of thinking I like to encourage, because this is the very thing that is missing. We just go along living our lives, and we don't take the time to train our vision or concentrate on certain things because, you know, we're busy. We have so much to contend with that we haven't been able to set aside time to really dissect and understand what it is, how we are living, what is really affecting our lives, and how are we being affected. Now, with this opportunity to file a special report, based on you can take recent events, or you can just take a panoramic view. What is it that we are experiencing as a nation and a nation within, or should say nations within the nation. How do we interpret that reality? Do we give it any thought at all? Is it something that you consider to be important enough to devote some special time to just saying, well, what's going on? Like this, these races in Georgia, they have already been reduced for us as just races. There's nothing extraordinary except that a precedent may be set here where we have an African-American senator coming out of all of this, and it's a big deal now. But do we really understand the import of what is happening? Do we understand what that person represents in the scheme of things? How we are to interpret that person, interpret this race, interpret where America is politically and where it intends to go. It hasn't hidden anything. It has been very clear. Donald Trump has been very clear about where he wants to take America as if it were his own personal property. And there is a reaction as opposed to action. It is not something we initiate. It is something that we react to as best we can. In this time, what occurs to you as perhaps a new or burgeoning political reality that we have to contend with, or that we are in fact contending with and trying to come up with different approaches with respect to empowerment? Not just say power. So I'm looking forward to your reports at 888-874-4888, to make it simple. We want to know from you, as a seasoned analyst, we want to know from you what you gather from observing the times that we are in. Who is doing what? How is that impacting on society as a whole? And certainly, how is it impacting on the people as a whole? Is there something here that is being born that needs to be studied a little bit more closely? Or are we being made once again, even with a new kind of political movement or burgeoning movement, being fitted into pre-designated slots so that the power that we imagined that we might have had or we might have gained is again under control, and we are not the ones controlling it? All right, that pretty much sums up the thinking behind this exercise today. How do you interpret our current reality, both as a nation and as nations within the nation? Would you dare use the word progress? Or is it just an adjustment so that it appears that we're moving, but we're also being contained? New methods of containment are happening. Ed from Jamaica, we get started with you today. You're on the air.
Hey, good afternoon, Yatrice. How are you?
Okay, Ed. How are you?
I'm still here, you know, me and my mom. In reference to what you were saying as far as giving a report on the direction of the nation and the political climate, taking the guise of a reporter, I see a lot of things going on. The election in Georgia really, I don't put too much emphasis on it as far as it being a practical, in a practical sense, because the Democrats have had control of the House and the Senate before. They had it with Obama. Obama had a mandate. He had over 75% of the electorate as far as voting wise, and he had control of the House and the Senate for 2 years, and he could barely get the Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act passed. And Clinton has had control of the House and the Senate before. These two parties are agreeable to David. They serve the ruling elite, and they don't have the common man's interest at heart, in my mind. So I don't see any of this political gamesmanship other than to generate funds and to promote the falseness of the party. What I do see in Georgia is the grassroots movement, because this wasn't of Kamala Harris and it wasn't of Joe Biden. It was of Stacey Abrams. It was of the people in Georgia who have been for years fighting voter suppression, promoting the franchise, promoting voting. And this was the result insofar as the voters there came out, to my belief, more against Trump and what the Republican Party stands for, which is what has become the embodiment of Trump. And it was more of a protest vote than a vote of action. And I believe that's where we're at with that. But I do like the fact that it's a grassroots movement. I do like the fact that there are a lot of young people involved in work, from what I've read and from what I've seen on YouTube and Twitter. There are a lot of young people involved in the movement. There are a lot of bright stars coming out of this, and hopefully that'll grow, and we'll be able to usurp this party sometime in the not-too-distant future. As far as what's taking place with the dog and pony show in the Senate, this is the dumbest thing that the Republican Party could have ever done, because there was no logical end game to it. Even if they had the numbers in the Senate, which they don't, the decision gets kicked back to the House. And you're going to let Nancy Pelosi and the Democrats elect the president? I mean, that's what it's going to boil down to. So this is basically just a funds grab. It's for the diehard Trumpians to fall on their swords and to show the 75 million people that voted for this lunatic that, hey, we're still here. We're still with you. We still believe in America and making America great again. It's a dog and pony show. As far as what Trump is doing and how he's posturing, he's doing what he's always done. He's letting the ruling elites know. He's letting the Republican Party know and the Democrat Party know that he's always going to be here, that he's still going to be an influence, and that you're going to still have to kowtow to him even in another 4 years, which right now looks like he's the prevailing force in the Republican Party, and the grand old party is basically garbage. So, I mean, the things I like, what I'm seeing now, is the grassroots, is the community activism. We've got to get back to a sense of community. We've got to get back to a sense of fidelity. And that's the only way we're going to persevere over this current political climate and get some of the things that we need as common people. The coronavirus is still here. According to the numbers, there's still a lot of people dying, and there's still a great consensus with this vaccination thing. The variants that are popping up, I've got my own ideas about that. But how this government responds to that, how you respond to the health crisis, how you respond to the homelessness crisis, is going to determine whether those grassroots forces are truly backing Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, the Democratic Party in the whole, or shooting off and doing something completely different, which is what I believe needs to be done. These are desperate times, and they call for dramatic and out-of-the-box action. And I think we're at the precipice of that.
Do you believe that, from what we're seeing, that efforts already are afoot to contain this burgeoning movement that yielded a spectacular result?
Oh, definitely. I mean, there's always, well, that, you just look at the history of this country. Anytime a dynamic new social movement comes to bear and people, and it's popular, the powers that be try to co-opt it. And there's a co-opting in here. I mean, Biden and Kamala Harris and the Democratic Party had nothing to do with what really took place in Georgia as far as turning Georgia into a new battleground state. This was the work of local activists. This was the work of Stacey Abrams. This was the work of people that have been in on the ground in Georgia doing this for years, because voter suppression has been the stalwart. They're talking about this guy, I can't recall his name right now, who Trump called on the phone as a hero. This guy is voter suppression number one. He did what he had to do because he was afraid of legal ramifications. But he's no hero. He's no stalwart. They've already, as if you look at the news, they initially removed 93,000 people from the voting rolls and never checked with the post office to see if they still live where they live. And that's still a bone of contention that's being brought by Stacey Abrams' camp against these people. So, I mean, we can't let them rewrite history like they always try to do. These people are not heroic. They are covering their behinds because a madman is holding them up against the fire. But they don't have the moral presence to make a clear stand, because they're afraid that if they don't go with this guy, they're going to get bounced.
Uh-huh. So in your report, what would you crystallize everything down to? How many key points would you say you will make in your report?
Well, number one, we're seeing what I believe is the demise of the old guard. We're seeing what I personally believe is the destruction of capitalism in the American sense. The old political parties, the old controlling forces they had their head so in that Washington bubble that they can't really see what's coming. We're also seeing a new dynamic of younger people in their 20s and their 30s who are tired of business as usual, and they're mobilizing. They're using the vote. They're using what is at their disposal. Like Adam Caton Powell said, what's in your hands? They're using what's in their hands, and they're getting people in power or people in a political position that are commensurate with the needs of the common people. And that's a burgeoning movement. That's what we got to be careful. We got to not let the old guard, who's basically drowning, grab onto that and try to put it in their back pocket and rewrite history. So I believe we're in a paradigm shift. It's going to take a little while. It's going to be hyper-local. And you got to keep your eyes open. You got to always organize and agitate. But I believe we're in the midst of what I hopefully is the end of capitalism in America and beginning of something different.
Thank you so much for your very comprehensive response today. You touched on some very important points, and I'm hoping, let's see people join you in that regard of trying to understand what it is we are witnessing unfold in Georgia. Thanks, Ed, for calling in. 888-874-4888 is the number to call. We're looking at a report, or looking for your report, on what is happening. And we're using as a case in point what has happened and continues to unfold in Georgia, where because, and nobody denies it, because of the groundswell of grassroots support, the Republican Party technically has been ousted. And the people can claim a victory, at least for now they can claim a victory, because they organized and they put them out. These people that were displaced were people who were to be acolytes of Donald Trump, and Trump had probably configured that they would be the ongoing tentacles that he could spread and extend into Congress, and by so doing still maintain some very important measure of control. Well, that has been thwarted. It has been thwarted. But we need to understand what it was, and we need to find out for ourselves, how did this happen? Well, we got some indications from Ed where it started. He said clearly it is a grassroots movement. And this is reason now to refocus attention on political activism. Where does it go? What does it accomplish? What does it see as the primary mission here? 888-874-4888 is the number to call. I'm looking for analytical minds today, and I was hoping we'd have a deluge of such minds try to get in and tell us what, if they were to write a report, to submit a report for analysis of what is happening or what has happened, what points would that report raise as seminal issues contributing to what most people are saying is a forward thrust? People are moving away from the old order. They have moved away in the case of these two Senate seats. And the prediction is they will continue to move away from the party. Well, that raises a bunch of questions. The Democratic Party cannot, with a straight face, claim that they have invested heavily in shoring up the political rewards of for African American communities. In fact, their sidelining of these communities, except at election time, they don't seem to be as involved in the day-to-day issues of how people are living, what they're entitled to, and what their job is to legislate and to agitate for beneficial change. So this is important in the sense that it is, for most of the Republicans today, they consider this a cataclysmic event. They certainly did not see this happening, and certainly not under the leadership or the piloting by Donald Trump, because he's a guy who can't be beat. He is the master of politics. No, he's not. No, he's not. And this was proof. The Republicans do not have a plan. And increasingly, we are worried that neither the Democrats have a plan. Henry from Chicago, you're on the air.
Hey, Chief, how's it going?
Okay. What's right. your report going to say?
Okay. Just a couple of questions. So is this going to be a long report, or is it going to be something that that's like a magazine article type of report?
No, it's going to be, this is a fictional thing. As I said,
we're
discussing this in a fictional way. But the report that you are making, in effect, is that you are taking the place of the kinds of reports that we have been needing for a long time to understand what is going on, but we haven't been getting such reports.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with the developments in just in the rearview mirror. They just got into the rearview mirror. We have an opportunity to dissect what happened here. And where does this lead us, if it leads us anywhere?
So basically the state of affairs in the country now, how do we get here, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
All right. So I guess in my report, because, you know, I was, you know, I wanted to, you know, I'm thinking about it in a you know, basically like in a realistic sense. I know you said it's fictional, but, you know, the way I formatted it was thinking about, you know, some of the stuff that we need to talk about that has happened, you know, say 4 years ago in regards to the election of Mr. Trump. And also, too, not just the political side of everything, but also the economic and also the technological and social side of things as well. So I guess I would have to start with, you know, talking about 4 years ago in regards to the masses of people who I wouldn't say the masses of people, but the enough people to get Donald Trump into office, which is an anomaly within itself, considering he's the first president to be, well, I wouldn't say he's the first president, but he's the first president in a while that has had no political elected office, you know, so it was, you know, just an anomaly. But in regards to the base, you know, his base of people that supported him all the way up to the end, in regards to you know, the racial aspect, the ethnic aspect, and all kind of social and economic aspects of you know, of how this country has been ran the last 4 years, plays into what is going on today. And so when we fast forward it to, you know, the beginning of the year, and we, you know, we have this pandemic that has happened, and the way the government has ignored, you know, the early warning signs of the pandemic from late 2019, and has caused, you know, a lot of economic devastation, has caused, you know, just basically health devastation. You know, we've lost we've lost hundreds of thousands of people to this coronavirus, and not even mentioning the damage that has done to those who actually have survived it. Because, you know, there's a lot of after effects that people have been, you know, reporting who have recovered from COVID, who's talking about the aspects of, you know, the long-term ramifications. And so when you look at that, you also look at both parties being opportunistic in this pandemic instead of trying to, you know, solve the issue of stopping deaths, stopping the contagion, basically trying to help those to recover who have caught it. You know, it's been a lot of opportunity that both parties have been trying to take advantage of, and not in the interest of the people, but in the interest of themselves. So, you know, just like what Ed previously said, you know, many people voted for Joe Biden not because they, you know, not because they like Joe Biden. It's basically a vote against Donald Trump. And so you have this, even with the Democratic Party, where they have become opportunists now, not really caring for the people, but just looking to, you know, establish themselves back in the White House again. And then now they're trying to establish themselves, you know, in the Senate with this race. So there's a lot of factors go into it. And like I said, starting from 4 years ago up until the beginning of the year. And then also, too, you know, you have the George Floyd killing and the attention that has brought on that, and the reaction of the grassroots who basically came out to the forefront during the start of the pandemic, you know, basically telling the people that enough is enough. And with them mobilizing at that point, kind of threw a monkey wrench within the powers that be to say, but what are we going to do about this? So there's been a lot of factors that have gone into it, but I would have to break it down to, you know, not just political, but social, economic, and health and technology as well.
All right. Well, thank you, Henry, for your panoramic view. Thanks so much. Ali from New York, how are you?
Hi, Idris, how you doing? I just wanted to say Happy New Year to you and to all your listeners. I was away for a little while, so I didn't listen to you, yes, but I'm back, and I'm always listening to Ed, David, my men from Chicago, who just spoke, Henry, and so I'm back, and I like to listen more than I like to call. I just wanted to say that, to put that out there. But I wanted to go back to your question. And mine's going to be written in a way that in three parts. I wanted to talk about women. I wanted to talk about community organizing. And I wanted to talk about, together with that, with voter oppression. Even though I'm not really happy with the Democrats, I'm really happy that these two gentlemen have won that election, not because I think it's going to be any better, but because we have to rub it to Trump. And so I just wanted to say for the beginning, and it's the saying, and I probably have it the wrong way, for every successful man, there is a woman behind. And it's not only Stacey Abrams. I just saw a young woman, and I know you don't watch Democracy Now. Her name is Anoa Changa, and she was talking this morning about the coalition, the organizing, the community. In order to succeed, you have to organize community. You have to do it multiracial. You have to do it ethical. And you have to do it in urban and rural area. When you put all those things together, I'm going back to women. Have you noticed that the two men, but every time that we talk about organizing, we always bring out one woman, two women, three women. So I just, for the men out there, even though you have more men that call your radio show, there is a woman running the show, and there is a lot of women. And I'm not talking about a strong woman, but woman that they have brain, because that is more important than anything else.
Right on.
So look how this woman, especially Stacey Abrams, but I'm pretty sure there is a tons of women around her, helping her out with this community organizing. And this is something that I don't think we're going to beat and get a lot of things with these politicians. It's going to be, and this is shows that it has to be organizing. That is so important. Look how she has been able to beat this guy in Georgia, even though he wanted this guy to look for 11,000 and change a vote to change it. And even with their voter oppression, they still have been able to beat these people. And that is incredible. They took out almost 200,000 people. They were able to win the state in the regular election, and probably they're going to be able to get these two senators. And who is behind? Going back to my original saying, always going back to this woman that everybody's talking about her. So I just wanted, that is my report right now. It's about woman power. It's about community organizing. And it's about this voter oppression that even out there, suppression, we are able to beat these people. And the last thing, a woman of color, a black woman, So that is the report for me today.
Oh, thank you, Ali. I accept your report. Thanks so much. David from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Good afternoon, Utrice.
Hello, David.
From Brooklyn report is coming. My title of my article will be How Things Change and Remain the Same. And the subpart of that title is The Oligarchy Wins Again. And I did talk about that in my post on YouTube, Brother David from Brooklyn Speaks. But here is my point. In spite of any change, like in Georgia with Minister Warnock winning and with President Obama getting into office, things changed the same. Since the beginning, when the oligarchy in this country took over from the British Crown and created what we call the United States of America, their goal was clear: to enrich themselves at the expense of all the people that they displaced in terms of what they did with the so-called Indians, the genocide, and to exploit the labors of the people who create all the wealth by their work. And that has not changed since the revolution, so-called, in the time when they broke away from the United Kingdom to today. Nothing has changed. So seeing people of color, so to speak, in high places is a wonderful tactic for those who rule. And we can see they are winning because their goal is to create as much wealth for themselves as possible, and they're doing it. We're hearing all the reports about the billions and trillions of dollars that they are making, those who rule the oligarch class, and they are winning. So letting some people of color have a position in a high place, as they have had since the civil rights movement, thousands of people in high places, has not changed the goal of those who rule. And at this time, they're at the highest point that they have ever been in terms of wealth, and everyone else is getting poorer, even though you got people of color in high places. But the mission of enriching the oligarch has remained, and it's working fine for them. So that is what we have going on now. And if anyone thinks you can reform the single party that we have that has two divisions, Republican and Democrat, you're kidding yourself. That's like saying that you have the ability to decide that a king cobra, you're going to turn him into an earthworm. It cannot be done. The people have no party that represents their interests. They may let people of color in high places, for example, but that does not change in any way the mission that they have to enrich themselves as capitalists, imperialists, here and around the world as they do. So that is nice that the minister won, and the other candidate is, looks like he's going to win too. That's wonderful, but I don't see that as a fundamental change to have a country that is here and functions for the benefit of the masses of people who live here, and not the oligarchy who sits at the top of the pyramid.
is this a good time to consider revitalizing the idea of a truly independent grassroots party?
Amen. That is what is needed if we're going to maintain the system, and they're going to do everything they can to make that not happen by continuing to fool the people, no matter what the people's phenotype is, into shepherding them into this one-party system that we have that works for those who rule, and that's the purpose of the party. So the only way that the people are going to make any significant change is to have their own parties. So the people need to do whatever is necessary to develop their own party outside of the Democrat and Republican divisions of the one-party state. So as long as that's not done, and the ruling class can let people of color have high positions, but things remain the same. So I think Obama was the biggest experiment in that work. And, you know, they're going to continue that, and they're going to always have some iteration to maintain control. So the people need to do one thing, and that is to wake up and understand what is happening. And you're not going to find out what's happening by going to the schools and going to the colleges. You have to study and do your own investigation. So that's the way David from Brooklyn sees it. And I talk about that on my post on Brother David in Brooklyn Speaks also.
And you have just filed a very commendable report, and I thank you. Thank you for that. We need to be reminded of these things. You see, we know. We really do know. But it's fleeting. We need it to occupy our attention for a longer span of time. We have to retool. And we've tried certain things that worked. We've tried certain things that didn't work. But it's time to really come to the point of deciding how scientific should we get and can we get in organizing in our collective interests. Thanks, everyone, for contributing so meaningfully today. I really look forward to being tutored and instructed by you and sharing it with everybody else listening. So let's get together again tomorrow and we talk some more. Thanks. Bye-bye.